There's a reason that we live so far from Hollywood. In the country, looking hard to find a home. With nothing perfect or considerable, we're so damn good. It's the story of your life. You're moving down the page.
Morning, Glory America. Bonjour, hi, candidate Hugh Hewitt on Monday, May the 23rd in the year of our Lord, 2022. I'm Hugh Hewitt, live inside the Beltway, and earlier this morning, big news was made from across the world. President Biden, on his Asian trip, said this, cut number whatever it is.
We agree with the one China policy. We signed on to it, and all the attendant agreements made from there. But the idea that it can be taken by force, just taken by force, is just not appropriate.
Are you willing to get involved militarily to defend Taiwan if it comes to that?
Yes.
You are.
That's the commitment we made.
That is very important to state. The so-called Davidson window, named for Admiral Davidson when he was commander of Pacific Forces, that China could lurch for Taiwan in the next 6 years because of the imbalance in forces in the Pacific, means that we needed to remove the ambiguity. We've always believed in strategic ambiguity. Would we not? Keeping guessing. Let's just see what happens. Taiwan goes its way. China goes its way. Maybe they'll integrate. The whole idea was, even up to 20 years ago, that the Chinese government was reforming. Taiwan was stabilizing. They had great healthy two-party system, that eventually the two would agree to a sort of federal arrangement a la Hong Kong, old Hong Kong in China. Well, President Xi destroyed that. The CCP's increasing militancy destroyed it. And the number of overflights they do with bombers and jet fighters, the number of threats they make, the number of ballistic comments they launch at Taiwan, the threats have been unending, and Joe Biden finally said it. So let's play it again. This is historic. The president is in a press conference. I think he's in South Korea. Maybe he's in Japan this morning. I'm not sure where he is. So I'll look that up. He's in Tokyo, and he's with the new prime minister of Japan. So that's even more symbolic, because Japan knows it will be drawn into this, too. And Japan is upping its defense budget. I mean, there are other stories. We'll get to them. But marked down May 23rd, 2022 is the day that Joe Biden drew his red line in the waters outside of Taiwan. Play it again, please.
We agree with the one China policy. We signed on to it and all the attendant agreements made from there. But the idea that it can be taken by force, just taken by force, is just not appropriate.
Are you willing to get involved militarily to defend Taiwan if it comes to that?
Yes.
You are.
That's the commitment we made.
Now, the president doesn't really look confident on the last moment. If you download the Salem News Channel, I'll play it again. He's reading from a statement on the first part. He's answering a question directly on the second part. On the third part, he pauses and he begins to wonder if he should have said yes. And he's sort of looking at his notes. But he said yes, and the United States is committed, and everyone has known it for a long time. Now, I don't know, and you don't know, and nobody in the United States military knows who's not either the president or the head of Pacific Command or whoever's in head of the submarine group that is running around. There's probably a three-star in charge of the submarines that are in the area off the China coast, and our boomer that's over there. If we have one or more than two, we've surfaced the Michigan before off the coast of China a few years ago. We wanted to send a message. They will sink Chinese ships. That's what people need to know. Play it one more time. The president this morning.
We agree with the one China policy. We signed on to it and all the attendant agreements made from there. But the idea that it can be taken by force, just taken by force, is just not appropriate.
Are you willing to get involved militarily to defend Taiwan if it comes to that?
Yes.
You are.
That's the commitment we made.
That, you know, that's the, according to Jerry Dunleavy, it's the third time he has said this, and the White House has walked it back. That you don't walk back what you say with the Japanese prime minister next to you. I don't care if every single person in the White House press room comes out to say and says that's not what he meant. That's what he said. That's what we do mean. There isn't any ambiguity, and that is long overdue. That should have happened under President Trump. It needed to happen under President Biden. Bravo, President Biden. Some other headlines, and I'll take your phone calls on this. 1-800-520-1234. Rising risk of recession creates new headache for Biden. The R word. There it is. Wall Street Journal front page. Why is that a risk? It's not a risk to Biden. He's going to get wiped out in the midterms that he's not running again. I know he wants people to think he might run again, but the guy's going to have trouble sprinting across, finishing strong here, and it's just not going to happen. And anyone who thinks so is just being misled. He hadn't declared that, but it's evident in his gait. He's just worn down already. He's been in the job for 15 months. He's 80 years, he's 79 years old. It's just too old to be president. You know that. I know that. Everybody knows that. Time to go to Delaware and build the library in Delaware somewhere. But Joe Biden doesn't face a risk of recession. It's not a new headache for him. It's a headache for every business owner and wage earner and those people who will be laid off. Because we're in the middle of soaring inflation, and a recession on top of that means job layoffs, business contraction. Look, it's cyclical. It's not the end of the world. It's not the Great Depression. It's not a panic. It's a slowing down of economic activity that means more people are out of work. Right now, you can get a job. There's a lot of demand. But you ought to go and get that job before the business would begin to close and get into that niche because you're going to need it. The president said that the U.S. is exploring monkeypox vaccines. Everybody should be concerned. That's nonsense. Monkeypox has been here before. It's very rare. It's easy to spot. It is nothing like COVID or any of the other diseases that you have to worry about in a pandemic like the 1918 flu, which are asymptomatic and develop with the inability to spot them. Every hospital in the world is on the lookout for monkeypox. So we got a couple dozen cases across the world. It's not a big deal. The president is, of course, apocalyptic in his rhetoric all the time. Stock market bottom remains elusive despite deepening decline. We're very close to a bear market, which means a correction of more than 20%. On Friday, this is brought to you by Birch Gold, great sponsor of the show, and they bring the market update. The market update is the news this morning. If you want to diversify your retirement funds, they're the specialists. The IRA recognize it. They're the third-party depository. You tell them how much you want to roll over. You roll over. They transform it into gold or silver at your direction. Gold this morning is at $1,860 an ounce, up 1% from Friday. On Friday, the Dow was up 8 points. The S&P was flat. The NASDAQ was down 33, and the 10-year Treasury dropped a little bit to 2.78. But gold went up 1% on Friday. Why? Because more and more people are figuring out this is a bad time not to have some gold. And the best place to have gold is in your retirement because you're not thinking about spending it for 30 or 40 years or 20 years or even 10 years. Go move some of it because if inflation does, we've never had inflation get above, I think, 12%. We could be knocking on that door this year given the crazy spending of the Democrats until we get the House back in Republican hands and the Senate back in Republican hands. Go to HughGold.com or text my name, Hugh, to 989898. That's HughGold.com or text Hugh to 989898. Another Wall Street Journal headline, small businesses lose confidence in the U.S. economy. Small businesses are flashing warning signs on the U.S. economy as inflation, supply chain snarls, and a shortage of workers, rising interest rates darken the outlook for entrepreneurs. You think so? Pennsylvania recount continues. 8,300 ballots need to be counted. Dr. Oz's 1,070 votes ahead of Dave McCormick. Third Circuit ruled on Friday that votes have to be counted if they're not dated by the voter. So that adds to the 8,300. Among those 8,300 are 1,500 ballots that Team McCormick thinks, because they come from military people overseas, are going to be very heavily for Dave McCormick himself, a veteran of the 82nd Airborne and Bronze Star recipient. We don't know, but they did get the Lancaster votes in. McCormick narrowed it a little bit from the time I talked to you on Friday, but it's really down to these 8,300 plus. I don't know if it's thousands, tens of thousands of ballots. Lots of people make that mistake. I think that's why the Third Circuit said you got to count them. In Georgia tomorrow, Brian Kemp is going to win easily. He's just going to win very, very easily his reelection for governor. Elon Musk called out Hillary Clinton on Twitter. Elon Musk is the new boon to Twitter. Everyone is now following Elon Musk. And more coming up. In Ukraine, the battling continues as Russia renews its attacks. Australia won. The Labour Party in Australia won big in the Saturday election. And that's because the incumbents get punished for inflation. Australia turns left by default, according to the Journal editorialist this morning. And the West braces for Shanghai shock as zero COVID nightmare ends. There's a lot of news. There's a lot to talk about. But the most important thing, the U.S. will defend Taiwan. Joe Biden says so. And thank goodness that he did. My phone number is 1-800-520-1234. If you have a reaction to that specific story, the U.S. is in with Taiwan. Let me know.
We agree with a one China policy. We've signed on to it. We agree with a one China policy. We signed on to it and all the attendant agreements made from there. But the idea that it can be taken by force, just taken by force, is just not appropriate.
Are you willing to get involved militarily to defend Taiwan if it comes to that?
Yes.
You are?
That's the commitment we made.
That I love that. Thank you, Joe Biden. First great thing he's done in his presidency is get rid of the strategic ambiguity policy. Taiwan is a nation of 24 million people. They are free. They are vibrant. I know a lot of Americans live there. The son of my college roommate has been living in Taiwan for decades, and many people go to Taiwan and make their lives there, and they love Taiwan. I've never been on the nation state of Taiwan, but the two Chinas, one China policy, one China, two systems policy has always meant that, okay, it's populated by Chinese people predominantly, and there is a ethnic native Taiwanese population, but it's majority Chinese, Han, and like China, which is majority Chinese, Han, they have two different systems, but they're all Chinese, and it's not a federal system yet. The hope has always been that there would be a federal arrangement. And by the way, the business relationships between the two countries have been deep and growing for decades. But the idea of military force is unacceptable, and we will defend them. And what does that mean? That means our American submarines, our Virginia-class submarines, which are there in force, will sink People's Liberation Army Navy plan boats. I think that's what it means. Robert in Colorado. Good morning, Robert.
Good morning, Hugh. How you doing, sir?
Good.
Just want to say I do not trust Joe Biden, not after Afghanistan and, of course, his future deal with Israel, what they're going to do to Israel in regard to Iran. I don't trust him at all.
Well, I don't either, I do love the fact that he drew a red line in the blue water around Taiwan. And so props where props are due. I'd be very worried if he had said, look, we don't, you know, he could have said a lot of things. He could have said, look, we don't talk about that, or look, you know, circumstances changed. Look, you know, he could have said, geez, a good guy. He didn't say anything. He said, yes, we will defend them militarily. Yes.
And that would be fine, but we, of course, have his track record. It doesn't say that. He's going to be selling another country down the tubes.
I just don't think that's going to happen. There won't be a Democrat left in Congress. There won't be. The American people saw and they remember Afghanistan and the cowardly cut and run. He tries to blame Donald Trump for that, and of course everyone knows that's nonsense. No, he can't do that. No matter how many times he's been wrong before, he can't do that. But I appreciate the call. I want to tell people about a couple of sponsors. One, the Job Creators Network is out there defending you in the teeth of this recession. And they started a new website devoted to combating wokeness in corporate America and businesses. Businesses have no business taking positions that do not advantage their shareholders. They have no business being woke. So Job Creators Network started the rockthewoke.com website to get you involved in counter-activism. Rock the woke. Rock the woke. I love that. Somebody thought that. Probably Alfredo Ortiz thought that up. Yeah, you know, back to MTV days 30 years ago, rock the vote. Now it's rock the woke. And they are rocked. Disney stock got shocked. And Disney shareholders are not happy. Coca-Cola shut up. By the way, Georgians are voting in record numbers after Georgia reformed its election law to make it easy to vote and hard to cheat. And so Rock the Woke is aimed at Coke. Rock the Woke is aimed at Major League Baseball. Rock the Woke is aimed at Delta. Rock the Woke is aimed at Disney. Job Creators Network, good on you. Very, very good on you. We can't have that. We can't say it enough. That corporate America has got to stay out of politics unless 100% of their shareholders agree with positions which are at best 50-50 positions. And usually on CRT and other things like that, they're minority positions. Most Americans agree that voting should be easy and hard to cheat. Easy to vote, hard to cheat. Most vast supermajorities believe in that. So Coca-Cola, get rid of the woke stuff. Rockthewoke.com. I'm coming right back, America. You hear it live on a Monday inside the Beltway. Stay tuned.
If you become a member of the universe, you not only get every previous Hugh Hewitt show, you get the after show, the best podcast you've never heard. www.hewuniverse.com.
Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt. It was a big weekend for me. The double coupon grandchild day was Friday. We were expecting, and grandchild number four, he's a strong lad, 8 pounds, 10 ounces, big boy, arrived on time as scheduled, mother and father doing fine, baby at home. Then along came his first cousin, hours away, separated by about 10 hours in time, not expected for another 3 weeks and maybe longer. It was first baby for my daughter-in-law. And so she is a sweet little angel at under 5 pounds, but she'll eventually just grow up. And I'm quite certain that between the cousins, there will be 1,000 exchanges. I'm older than you, and I'm smarter than you. But that made for quite the day on Friday, and quite the number of, you know, two cars at the hospital, make a run here, dad, thanks, do this, do that. And Nana, of course, the fetching Mrs. Hewitt, is with the brood far away, and I'm the one on site inside the Beltway where the second was arriving. So double coupon day for grandkids. Now, I know that's not unprecedented. It's just nothing we've dealt with before. And the good news is the other grandparents are also around, so we got plenty of helping hands for the new parents, and everybody is fine, and we are very, very thankful for that. We're grateful for that. But it was a busy day. Nevertheless, by Sunday morning, things had calmed down, and my old buddy Howie Kurtz runs Media Buzz. Fine show on Sunday morning. Now, I am normally in church on Sunday morning at 11 o'clock when Howie is on, and I have declined many opportunities to go. When I used to do Meet the Press, it taped at 9, I could always make church, but the Howie does it at 11, but I went to Mass at 7 a.m. and was able to figure it out. By the way, you know what's a terrible thing? Terrible thing. Outside of church, they were selling Dunkin' Donuts fundraiser boxes. Not Dunkin' Donuts. What are the best donuts in the world, Dwayne? The glazed donuts, the best donuts. Krispy Kremes.
Krispy Kremes.
Yeah, so I bought a box of it, and, you know, it just wasn't full. I got to explain to Mrs. Hill when she gets back today that it came that way. It came with 6 donuts in it. It was, you know, I don't even think that's fair. Do you? It's just not fair that, you know, you think you get 12 and I'll just show it to her. There are 6. You know, I don't know what to do.
That's right. It's inflation. That's what's happening.
That's it's inflation.
Right.
That's it. That's the ticket.
They're shorting supply. Right.
That's the ticket. I know the Knights of Columbus wouldn't do that, so I just think it's Krispy Kreme. It felt like, too. I just don't know. 6, half dozen of those donuts are gone. And
yeah, that's it, ticket.
That's exactly it. Inflation. So I think it's a terrible thing, actually, to sell Krispy Kreme glazed donuts outside of church. Because no matter, I mean, you're coming out of church and you're feeling good about the world and God, and you're grateful for 2 grandchildren, and there are these Krispy Kreme donuts.
And you're deluded into thinking they're already pre-blessed.
Yeah, they're pre-blessed, and you think there are a dozen of them, and it turns out, as I'll show, I'll put a picture out that niftily arranged half dozen donuts. In any event, I did get over to Media Buzz, and good long segment with Howie. Here it is from Sunday.
Joining us now here in the studio to talk media and politics is Hugh Hewitt, the syndicated radio host with Salem Media and a contributing columnist for The Washington Post. Great to have you on set. Look, the media are happy that Madison Cawthon lost after all his problems. And now the new target is Doug Mastriano, who won the Republican nomination, as you know, for Pennsylvania governor. He's insisted since 2020 that there was widespread fraud in the state. He says if he's elected, he'll transfer the power to pick presidential electors to the Republican-controlled state legislature. Is it fair for the press to paint him and others as a threat to a fair election?
No, but I think it is going to be unfair to cover Mastriano as an outlier in his party, unless in the same subject, same paragraph, they cover John Fetterman, the Democratic nominee for the Senate in Pennsylvania, as an outlier in his own party. So you have a very conservative Republican who is an outlier in his party, and you have a very left-wing Democrat who's an outlier in his party. And Fetterman, of course, has got the guy who got the shotgun on the young black man in the neighborhood, which is an almost self-destructive political act. That's far more radical than going to the rally on
January 6th.
Yeah. And Mastriano did not go into the Capitol. I want people to understand.
Yeah, I don't want to suggest that. Yeah. But now, the New York Times has a big story today saying that 44% of Republican state legislators in the 9 key battleground states have either voted to discredit or overturn or use their office to overturn 2020 results. And you have the former president, Donald Trump, loudly proclaiming day after day that this was the crime of the century. In fact, he says he's writing a book about this. How does that help Republicans in 2022 to keep pounding away on
it? Doesn't. In fact, looking backwards is a nightmare for Republican candidates. I would argue for every Republican candidate, do not look backwards. And we're going to see in Georgia, Brian Kemp's going to win handily. He's going to win handily.
Despite strong opposition from Trump.
Yeah. If Donald Trump could have picked one person to defeat this election cycle, it would have been Brian Kemp.
Right.
And he got David Perdue to run against him. And that's because nobody looks backwards in election. They look forwards in election. And so 2022 is a very great environment for Republicans. That doesn't mean all Democrats are going to lose. I was talking about Pennsylvania. Josh Shapiro, their nominee, he's going to be like Doug Ducey in 2018 in Arizona. Very bad year for Republican. Doug Ducey, an incumbent Republican governor, won by 14 points. I think Shapiro will do very well in Pennsylvania.
Speaking of generally,
if you look forward, you win. If you look backwards, you lose.
Speaking of Pennsylvania, that primary between Dr. Oz and David McCormick seems headed for an automatic recount. Trump publicly urged Oz to declare victory because, quote, it makes it much harder for them to cheat with the ballots they just happened to find. Now, many in the press are saying this undermines faith in elections.
Look, the former president has an interest in getting people to go to Truth Social. That's his new business. So saying things like that get attention work for him. In fact, the Third Circuit ruled just this weekend that they're going to count ballots in Pennsylvania that don't have a date on it. That's a 1,070 vote margin for Oz at this point. There are about 8,300 ballots outstanding that are Republican. There are going to be more if they count uncounted. We are going to recount. Don't declare anything. You'll hurt yourself in the general election, even if Oz wins. I endorse McCormick, by the way, so I want to be clear to the audience. But I think it's going to be neck and neck. It could be a one-vote race. Yeah. Don't declare anything is over until someone adjudicates that and signs it. Otherwise, you'll end up looking foolish in the fall.
Yeah, I can't do all this math. Yeah. Now, the New York Times reported the other day, Hugh, that the Justice Department had asked the House January 6th committee for transcripts of his interviews, and it was treated on the other cable news networks as bombshell news. Here's how it played out on MSNBC.
Something that might change this entire conversation. This could be a game changer. The New York Times has just broken the story that the Justice Department has requested transcripts from the January 6th committee.
Endless hours. Fox didn't cover it. Now, it seems to me it's a process story, noteworthy, but exactly what you'd expect in a criminal investigation.
Yeah, I think we ought to fine everyone who uses the term game changer on a television set. This is not a game changer. The January 6th committee is illegitimate. Liz Cheney is a friend of mine. I hope she is reelected, but I have always said that's an illegitimate committee. 837 people, I think, have been indicted. Dozens of them have pled guilty or been convicted, and all of them deserve what they get. But the United States as a whole, profoundly uninterested in that committee, because that committee is a rump committee that was not duly constituted and I think broke the rules from the beginning.
We'll see when the hearings start next month. Okay.
Those ratings, near zero. I had better ratings on MSNBC than that hearing set is going to have.
Ouch.
Yeah.
Okay, now, in the serious subject, in the wake of the horrible, racist mass shooting in Buffalo, what's your view of this widespread journalistic effort to blame these heinous killings by a crazed suspect on conservative media outlets?
I think it's abhorrent, and it really devalues the lives of victims. There were, I had Secretary Clinton on after she lost the election. We agree there are about 600,000 white extremists in the United States, white supremacists. If even 1% of them are violent, we have a big problem on our hand that's got to be investigated. They find their way to that extremism, not through conservative media, but through the internet and through the rabbit holes that people go into, like QAnon, et cetera, not through watching television shows. And anyone who peddles that from the left about people who commit violence, you know, there was a Chinese communist supporter who shot up a church in my old hometown of Orange County. No one went and blamed the Chinese Communist Party outlets for this deranged man with an ideology. Mm-hmm. The shooters are responsible for the shooting, and not any particular host. I do think that hosts like you and me have got to be very careful not to accidentally trade in the terms that are current
on the wildest website. Replacement theory, I think, is an abhorrent term to use. I would not use it. I think that triggers a lot of people on the right, on the far right, thinking that you're one of them.
But there is a media effort to tag Republicans and conservatives as endorsing replacement theory if they've just simply talked about the political impact.
And that's illegitimate. That's completely illegitimate, because people who talk about illegal immigration, like I have since 2004, calling for a double-sided fence on the border. I also want to make amnesty available for everyone who's here who hadn't broken any law. Immigration is so complex that no one ought to try and categorize anyone based on any particular view. But when a term becomes radioactive, and replacement theory is, it is incumbent upon candidates and media alike to treat it as a radioactive term and then to avoid it so as not to be misunderstood, because those 600,000 crazy people are out there.
Hugh Hewitt, great to see you again.
Howard,
thanks for coming in.
So I like working with Howard. We move quickly. I want to go back to the Pennsylvania Senate race and explain something. Dr. Oz has 1,070 vote lead, and all of the regular counting is done. There are piles of mail-in ballots that get counted last, and they'll be counted today and tomorrow, and we'll figure out whether or not, I think he needs to get out of those. He needs to pick up, I did all the math, and then we didn't get into it, and now I've forgotten it. Something like, it's a matter of picking up 4,325 votes out of the 8,300. That's a heavy lift. It's possible, because among those 8,300 are 1,500 votes from military abroad, which McCormick is counting on. So of the 4,300 that he needs, that means he's got 1,500 or 1,400 in the bag. But that still is a big percentage, bigger than he has won thus far. So you'd rather be Oz right now. The spanner is that the Third Circuit on Friday, ruling on the November of last year election, said, hey, Pennsylvania, your rule tossing out votes that have been received in a timely manner but weren't dated by the voter, those go back in. And the McCormick campaign, legal team led by Chuck Cooper, sent out a letter to everybody in every county saying, count those ballots. So we're going to have, it's Florida 2000, we're going to have lawyers over every precinct and every county election board counting. So I have no guesses. I don't know what's going to happen, but I know no one should claim victory when you can't even claim it based on litigation or adjudication. No one's the votes haven't been tallied. I think it's crazy Pennsylvania's taken so long. But it's Pennsylvania. You got the Steelers fans counting in some places, and they run out of toes and fingers. I got Relief Factor right here. I'm back to one package a day. Why is that? I was able to do 3 miles yesterday. I haven't got a giddy up in my limp. It's back to normal. Hurts a little bit, but that's what happens. When 8 days ago you fall down. Now I'm better. Now the bruise is really quite magnificent. It's maybe the best looking bruise I've ever had. It's probably 8 square inches. It's big, because I did hit that thing hard when I fell. If you missed last week and you're on vacation, I saw the branch that I hit. I didn't see the one in front of it. And it was across the, it was a villainous branch. And I think we can all call it that. They used to just grab out for my golf balls. I was telling Ricardo in Miami, who is a scratch golfer, and I'm not saying he uses foot wedges. I'm just saying he's a scratch golfer. Don't give him. Strokes, that trees used to just go after my golf balls. Now they're going after me. It's like the Ents are after me. I'm not Soramon. I'm just Hugh Hewitt. Come right back. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, joined by Salena Zito, who has been covering Pennsylvania like nobody. Salena, I just went through the math on the Pennsylvania Senate race. What's your understanding of the 8,300 ballots, and what's your understanding of how many undated ballots might be back in play because of the Third Circuit decision on Friday?
I have no idea. there are so many known unknowns, as Rumsfeld used to say,
yes,
that it's anybody's guess. I mean, I think we're at the about 9,000 to 11,000 mark, but that is of Republican ballots. But that's all we know right now. Oz is ahead. The only thing that the thing that McCormick may have in his pocket is that he had invested in an absentee mail ballot program, which means you target people, you send the ballots out, and you kind of know they're your voters.
Yeah.
And so I think that's where we are. I have a conclusion to this story that I think is important. I think no matter which man wins, they're going to beat John Fetterman if they run a good, solid campaign. I think that at the end, whoever doesn't win, you shake hands with the victor. You go off and run the state party, which has been in shambles for years. You wait a year, then you run against Bob Casey, who will ultimately be primaried and be a weakened candidate if he even survives a primary in 2024.
Let me pick up on the numbers for a second. One of the things that frustrates me, Salena, is reporters hate to say they don't know, and you and I both say we don't know. And so I read every story. I go on Twitter, #PASN, #PASenate, and what I come up with, 8,300 Republican ballots for sure
right,
have not been counted. But we've got this Third Circuit opinion coming down on Friday, and the McCormick campaign led by Chuck Cooper sending everyone a letter saying count those, and that's the number. I don't know how many there are of the 80. If it was just 8,300, the McCormick campaign would need 4,350 of the 8,300, which is, that's a pretty big lift. On the other hand, there were five candidates. People could have thrown a ballot, an absentee for Carla Sands, could have thrown one for Jeff Bardos, could have thrown one for, of course, Oz, but you win a vote every time it's for McCormick. You win a half vote whenever it's not for Oz. It's very complicated math, but this question of the Third Circuit, so I just want to dial in. You said between 9 and 11,000. It would seem to me that we're talking about Steelers fans here, Salena. There could be tens of thousands of people who didn't put the date on the thing, right?
Yeah, and that's when we get into weird territory, because these are the kinds of issues that Republicans have fought against. You know, not having a signature, not having a date. These are the things that Republicans were really pissed off about in 2020. Now this might be a possibility that it's counted.
I think it's adjudicated. I really think that the Pennsylvania election committees have to count votes with no date but with a signature.
Yeah.
That's the ruling from November. So I think, I just don't know what the number is. And I wish that Pennsylvania's 60, how many counties have they got, Salena?
67.
So there's 67 counties that have got 67 registrars who have to give 67 vote totals. And it's not that hard. And I don't know why it hasn't happened. Let me talk to you about a point I made yesterday. Howie Kurtz wanted to talk about Mastriano. And I said, look, Mastriano is a very conservative from the far right reach of the Republican Party. But Fetterman is from the far left reach of the Democratic Party. So every time I see a Mastriano story, there better be a Fetterman paragraph about pulling a gun on a young black man, because that's what he got in his car, drove around, tracked him out. It's very much like the Aubrey case, only thank God he didn't shoot the kid. Do you think that will happen, that every time Mastriano is brought up, that Fetterman will be considered in the same kind of way?
Sort of, actually, yes. That's Fetterman's challenge. For as healthily as he won his primary, he's also not very well liked within a large block of his party. And the party establishment for whatever you think of establishment wings of parties, they're not particularly, I mean, they just don't like each other and have gone at each other. So I think it will happen, probably not in this, in the same sentence, but you're going to see a lot of that. I mean, that's...
So let me check if I've got the facts right. In 2013, Fetterman says he heard gunshots fired. He went into his house, got his shotgun, got into his car, drove around the neighborhood, saw a black jogger, a young man who was running, and stopped him with the gun in his hand. Am I right?
Yeah. We covered that back in 2013. Yeah, you didn't get anything wrong.
And he got nominated in the Democratic Party.
Welcome to 2022.
Salena, we're going to have to talk a lot about this race, but I just want one rule. If they cover Mastriano as very conservative and from the fringe of his party, they got to cover Fetterman as beyond the fringe of his party, because I don't know of any other Democrat who's pulled a gun on a young black jogger like John Fetterman did in Pennsylvania in 2013. SelenaZito.com for everything Selena writes. Don't go anywhere, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Job Creators Network.
Morning, Glory America. Bonjour. Hi, Canada. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Thank you for listening to the Hugh Hewitt Show. The key cut of the morning. I'm inside the Beltway. I'm live. About 2 hours ago, President Biden, standing next to Japanese Prime Minister, said this, cut 14.
We agree with a one China policy. We've signed on to it and all the attendant agreements made from there. But the idea that it can be taken by force, just taken by force, is just not appropriate.
Are you willing to get involved militarily to defend Taiwan if it comes to that?
Yes.
You are?
That's the commitment we made.
That is the commitment we made. Because the Taiwan Relations Act is a statute. All right, so we have no treaty with the People's Republic of China. We have the One China, Two Systems Agreement from the Shanghai communique back when Nixon was president and Kissinger was Secretary of State, 50 years old this year. And it's been 50 years, and it's worked in terms of keeping China out of a war with Taiwan by recognizing that they have to reconcile their systems their own way. And for many years, that reconciliation occurred incrementally, bit by bit, with the two systems agreeing on a lot of commercial exchanges. There are a lot of Taiwanese businessmen who fly back and forth every single day, every single week, to the mainland. And at the same time, Taiwan has always kept up a robust defense, and the United States' guarantee has been unspoken but very real. Now that China is the People's Liberation Army Navy is regularly threatening China, and the People's Liberation Army Air Force is regularly violating Taiwan's airspace, and the People's Liberation Army spokespeople and the Chinese Communist Party spokespeople are regularly being belligerent, the necessity of being clear on what the United States' response will be has grown. This is the third time Joe Biden has said, we will use military force. The first two times the White House said no policy has changed. The president really didn't mean what he said. I don't know what they're going to say today. He's on the international stage next to the Japanese prime minister. And he's committing the United States to use military force. That means submarines and ships. That means airplanes based in Japan. That means if you try and invade Taiwan, it ain't going to happen. It's not going to be Ukraine. We're not just going to give them weapons. We're going to be involved. That's the number one conflict, because if Taiwan falls, the South China Sea becomes basically the Caribbean for China. And that isn't acceptable given the amount of international travel in other states. I mean, Vietnam will have a say in that. Japan will have a say in that. The Philippines has a say in that. That's a big body of water. It's obviously an open ocean. It's not a sea. It's not the Black Sea. It's not integral. China has historically, through centuries, been a land power. There was one period where they went adventuring. One famous Chinese admiral, whose name I can't remember right now, Admiral Stavridis has written up about, who went far and away, and the Middle Kingdom liked people to know that they were the Middle Kingdom, and they were in charge of a lot, and they accepted tribute from a bunch of countries. But one sailor hundreds of years ago does not a claim to the South China Sea make, and we have never accepted that. No modern international law framework is accepted other than the South China Sea is indeed part of the world's waterways. Iran tries the same thing with the Straits of Hormuz and the waters off of the Persian Gulf. And some people call it the Arabian Gulf, just to make sure Iran knows that they don't get to. And when Iran tried to change that, we sunk every ship in their fleet in 1988, I believe. I think it was Reagan's last act. They started screwing around with tankers, and Reagan pulled the trigger, and not a lot of people remember, but we sunk every single Iranian boat. It would not be that easy. China is a nuclear power. China is a very advanced military, but they're not capable of following our Virginia-class submarines. They don't know what we've got. I don't know what we've got, except I get lots of winks and nods from people with 2 and 3 and 4 stars in the Navy on their shoulders telling me, we got a whole bunch of stuff the Chinese don't know about. And they will not really, I don't know if it's Doctor Strange multiverse stuff, but they really do not want to mess around with us. And so that's the big news of the morning. And the president was unusually clear. He was not very good in South Korea. He's in Japan this morning, and he had obviously jet lag is better, more coherent, yesterday. Cut number two. Message for North Korea, and he said hello, period. Then he tried to make a statement on Hyundai and electric vehicles. Cut number three.
And thanks to Hyundai, we are being part of this transformative automobile sector and accelerating us on the road where we're going to be handling to the United States of all electric future. That's what we're shooting for.
You know, I just hate to rain on anyone's parade. I like electric cars. Good for you. There is no long-haul truck capable of doing what America's truckers do every day, which is keep this country running on diesel and gasoline. All right? It just does, there is no truck with a battery big enough that can do the long-haul freight that our truckers do every single day. So if you're on the road right now and there's a truck, and it might be the morning's bread, and it might be the oven that is bound for the new home, or it might be the drywall to build the new home, or it might be the iron ore that goes to the factory that makes the steel, that makes the, we need trucks, and trucks run on gas. We're not going all electric. Cut number four.
But batteries that we made at this new facility in Georgia are going to power cars without one drop of gasoline and increase security of our battery supply chain as well. That's going to save families money at the pump because they can skip the pump altogether.
All right. Can you afford to buy an electric vehicle? Can you? But I'm wondering if there are truckers out there. 1-800-520-1234. When the president talks about electric vehicles, I'm just curious what you think. If you're a trucker and you're on the road right now, you occasionally call me up. 1-800-520-1234. Let's talk to some truckers about this, because I read the story about it this week, and nowhere are we even within a decade of electric trucks. And I just think it's silly for people to think we're doing it. I'm glad if you're driving an electric vehicle. I think we ought to build. There's a gradual evolution going to electric cars. Their price will come down. You'll be able to afford them. But if you're a trucker and you want to talk about gasoline prices, 1-800-520-1234. In fact, it's just Kamala Harris, the vice president, out talking this weekend on Friday about electric vehicles. Cut number five.
It was fantastic. The press actually rode on an electric school bus, just so you know. So I think they got the real inside feeling for what this means, right? And so what we all experienced is on an electric school bus, on an electric bus, no exhaust, no diesel smell.
No exhaust. Really? Wow. No exhaust. Did you get it in an electric long-haul truck? Cut number six, the vice president.
Now, I've spoken to a number of drivers, for example, who have recently switched to electric buses, and they stressed the importance of a quiet engine, which is much bigger than just you can have a conversation and hear each other. It helps the drivers hear the road, which, of course, helps keep our children safer.
Hear the road. That's like Be the Ball, Chevy Chase, Hear the Road. Ken is in Texas. Good morning, Ken. Are you driving long haul or short haul today?
Actually, yeah, I don't drive anymore. I work for a major retailer. We've got over 19,000 stores in the U.S., and we looked at buying electric trucks. They were about $400,000, and even with the tax credit, they were about $200,000 more than a normal diesel unit, and they were only good for local. We could do about a 250-mile one-way radius with them.
Yep. Okay, I'm talking to truckers this morning, but I appreciate that, Ken. So did you go out and buy, let me talk to Billy in Oklahoma. Good morning, Billy.
Good morning, sir. How are you?
Good. Are you driving this morning?
I am.
All right, where are you going from and to?
Well, I'm an Edge driver, but I am on the road this morning. But what I wanted to voice my opinion on is I follow the electric car, you know, try to keep up with the mileage and how far they go and blah, blah, blah. It's never going to happen with the big haulers. And just to make a real quick point, the last time I paid $5 a gallon for diesel, Obama was in office. Never did that after his administration.
It's back.
It's back because of the Biden administration. So
of course,
I
mean,
I wanted to throw out there.
And by the way, in Washington State, they've actually floated, they've changed the pumps to handle double-digit dollar gas prices. Not there yet, but they went out and preemptively moved it so you would be paying, that you could see how much the price per gallon was. That's an ominous sign. Stay tuned, America. 1-800-520-1234. Connection to the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Prison Fellowship Academy.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, Inside the Beltway Live. Let me tell you that I'm not going to ask you for money right now. I'm going to talk to you about prison fellowship because I think of them whenever I see a horrific story. The Buffalo shooter was not a recidivist. But I saw a story last night when I was doing show prep. Man 48 fatally shot on a Manhattan subway train. Shooting aboard a Q train in Lower Manhattan on Sunday was in the afternoon, was unprovoked. There was actually no exchange between the victim, the person who was killed, and the murderer still at large. And I thought about crime in America, and crime in America is skyrocketing for a bunch of reasons. A lot of them are fentanyl-related. And the First Step Act that Donald Trump signed gave a lot of people a chance to come out and not be recidivists. Those who succeed are going to be a lot of them are going to be those who went through the Prison Fellowship Academy. And I don't want your money. I want your attention. I'd love you to go over to HughHewitt.com and click on the banner at the very top that explains to you what Prison Fellowship is doing. What Chuck Colson began and continues long after he's gone to his reward is work with people to get them ready for another life. Todd Stafford is the program manager at Goose Creek Correctional Facility in Alaska. And he tells us he's seeing God at work every day in the lives of these prisoners.
The goal of the program is to produce good citizens, people that are going to be in our communities. We know that, at least here in Alaska, 95% of everyone incarcerated today will eventually be released, and they're coming back to our communities. They'll be our neighbors. They'll be our coworkers. So the question is, what do we want to do to see people come back into our communities with a pro-social attitude, ready to be a part of the community and be a productive part?
And the way they do that is detailed. Just visit the website over at the top of HughHewitt.com. I'm not asking you for money. I'm asking for your attention. Learn about prison fellowship. There is hope. Maybe you know someone who is in prison. Maybe you know somebody who's been in prison a few times and they have always scoffed at the pre-PF programs. Tell them to scoff no more. Just take a look because they do succeed. Where prison fellowship is, there is hope for people to come back, and people hire folks who've come through the academy. People are glad to embrace returning people who've done their time, and they paid their price, and they're ready to go back into society, and Prison Fellowship helps them get ready for that. Please visit the website and learn about the Prison Fellowship Academy. Back to the phones. Dee is in Ohio. She or he is a trucker. Hi, Dee.
Hi. How you doing?
Good. Where are you driving this morning?
I'm in Ohio, headed to Indiana, and taking a load to Tennessee.
Okay, I'm glad you're not stopping in Indiana. That's a very, you'll talk to Butler people like Schroeder, and that could throw your whole day off. So tell me, what do you think about electric vehicle talk, Dee, when you hear that?
I don't care for them at all.
I don't see
how we're going to be able to charge. I mean, how long is it going to take to charge a whole battery?
There is none. There is no electric truck that can do what you're doing right now. What are you carrying this morning?
Just picking up steel.
All right, perfect. Steel. Yeah, there is no electric vehicle. I mean, a school bus is nice. The wheels on the bus go round and round. The school bus does not carry steel from Ohio through Indiana to where are you going?
I'm going to Tennessee.
Tennessee. And then you're going to, what do you pick up in Tennessee and come back bringing what?
I have no idea until I get there.
You know what? That's why I invested in a company called Envase because they make it efficient. I'm not sure if you like all the changes in the GPS and the computerization, Dee, but boy, it sure is a different business than it was when you started, isn't it?
It is. It is.
Well, Dee, thank you. I hope you listen every day when you can find the station. Thank you. Let me go to Ken in Kentucky, another trucker. Ken, where are you in Kentucky? Where are you heading? What are you carrying?
Well, I'm a local guy in Louisville carrying, I work for waste management, so I'm carrying waste to commercial roll-off machine.
Any chance of an electric truck that can do your job in your view?
They probably could do it in the short haul, but the longer hauls, they certainly can't. And my brother flies airplanes for UPS, and UPS and FedEx don't have any batteries in their airplanes that'll be able to carry things across the ocean.
Another great point. It's just silly. School bus talk is silly, sleight of hand. to benefit the green voter out there. It does nothing for the Kens and the D's of the world. More of your phone calls coming up. 1-800-520-1234. I'm talking to America's truckers this morning. I do this occasionally because they're on the road for you as we speak. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Stay tuned. Welcome back, America. Up now, I'm joined by Scott Pruitt, former administrator of the Environmental Protection Agency under Donald Trump, former attorney general of Oklahoma, candidate for Oklahoma's open Senate seat vacated by Jim Inhofe at the end of the year. Good morning, Scott Pruitt. Welcome back to the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Good morning, Hugh. I understand congratulations are in order. You had grandchildren on the weekend, a double play tandem.
A double play. It was double coupon day on Friday. Thank you, General. I didn't expect the second one, but your friend and mine, James, had one, as did my daughter. And it's a great day to be a grandpa. I know that's not your land yet. You still got kids who are too young, but thank you. General Pruitt, talk to us about this campaign. Oklahoma's got a crowded field. I have learned from the Pennsylvania campaign, polling is wrong again. So I don't even know what the polls say, and I could care less because they blew it again in Pennsylvania.
Look, and at the end of the day, Oklahoma is center when it comes to the energy issue. And domestically and globally, energy is front and center. So the price of the gas pump is expected to be $6 in August. Why is that? Because of what this administration has done since the outset. It sent a message to capital markets, don't invest in fossil fuels. It's prolonged the permitting processes for obviously pipelines and canceling those. So we need more pipelines, not less. We need more refineries, not less. I mean, the very things that could occur to lower gas prices in this country, this administration has done exactly the opposite. And as you know, Hugh, these, you know, currency and energy are tools in the toolbox with respect to geopolitical issues. So to the degree that the U.S. is not producing energy, it makes China and Russia stronger. So look, we have to send a clear message across this country. The days of trying to put people at odds on whether we should produce energy or not, that's an old way of looking at things. We can produce our energy. We can provide low-cost energy to the American people and impact issues globally. We can use technology to make sure that our environmental footprint is safe and secure. We can do both. We truly can, and it's time that we start approaching it that way.
Now, General Pruitt, I'm talking to truckers this morning, and there are no electric trucks out there that can carry long haul. There are no airplanes that can run on batteries. It is silly. I heard the president and the vice president over the weekend talking about electric cars. I'm glad that there are electric cars. We should want all of the above, but we're not getting rid of gasoline.
That's right, Hugh, and think about it for a moment. All the incentives, all the subsidies that have occurred with this administration and before with respect to the electrification of our car fleets across the country, still less than 3% of the entire market is electrical vehicles. And that's not changing anytime in the near future. How about having, you know, an approach that says, let's advance technology like carbon capture and sequestration that allows us to scale it more efficiently and to ensure that we have less harmful elements in the atmosphere and also produce energy for this country, you know, that our power grid is safe and secure and reliable and resilient, you know, that we have lower cost gas in this country. I mean, there has been a war on North American energy since this administration took place. When I left in 2018, the administration, we were energy independent and some would say dominant. We were exporting energy to the world. Gas prices were around $2. It's almost three times that, 300% higher as we approach August. This administration has done that. This is not Putin's fault that America is going through what we're going through. It is this administration's fault. They have caused this to occur, and they need to have a different approach.
You can't say that enough, Scott Pruitt. Let me turn to the other issue. I've had other Oklahoma candidates on. They talk about the McGirt decision. You're the attorney general of Oklahoma and a successful one until Donald Trump brought you to Washington to be in his cabinet. What do you think of McGirt?
Well, I mean, think about it this way. You know, people have looked at that only from a criminal jurisdiction perspective. You know, can you prosecute non-Indians for crimes that occur on tribal land? It's far broader than that. You know, the U.S. Supreme Court wrongfully reestablished reservations in Oklahoma that impacts about 47% of the state. You know, that affects taxing authority. That affects regulatory authority. That obviously affects criminal jurisdiction. And there's no clarity around that. And for anyone to say that, you know, think about mineral rights, you know, in the state of Oklahoma. Think about the development of oil and gas in the production of energy. Now those things are very much uncertain. And Congress is center in fixing that. Congress has every right and authority to come and disestablish reservations if they choose to do so. So to think that we're somehow dependent upon the courts to fix this problem, that's a wrong view of the world. We need a U.S. senator in Oklahoma, and I seek to be one, that provides clarity, protecting the sovereignty of the state of Oklahoma, with respect to these issues around regulatory taxing and other related matters, and the Congress is central to making sure that happens.
Scott Pruitt, I know you're pro-life. When you were the Attorney General of Oklahoma, you defended pro-life statutes that the people of Oklahoma want. I don't know if we're going to get Roe and Casey reversed today, but I think it's going to happen by the end of the month. What do you say to the people who are out there picketing in front of justices' houses and basically hysterical on TV?
Well, two things. Number one, the focus on the unborn child, providing constitutional protections to the unborn child from the moment of conception on a state-by-state level must occur. If this decision comes down as we expect it to come down and sends the authority to the states, each state in this country then must take up the banner. The battle has just begun to provide protections, not just through criminal statutes, not through just statutory enactments, but through constitutional changes on a state-by-state basis that does what Roe, you know, denied in 1973, declare that an unborn child is a person from the moment of conception legally under the 14th Amendment. So that's number one. Number two, you know, when you look at what the court, this leaked opinion, and I know the investigation is still ongoing, but having spent quite a bit of time there as I served as Attorney General, we had three cases that I was involved with at the Supreme Court. That process, the sanctity of that process, is something that's important. And for it to be impacted as it was through this leak, it's truly tragic, and it needs to be dealt with in an aggressive fashion. But we must not lose sight of the overall victory, potentially, of the unborn child finally being protected constitutionally in this country on a state-by-state basis.
Now, Scott Pruitt, there are a lot of people in this race. One of them is a congressman who's released a new ad. I don't know him. I think his ACU rating is about 60%. I'm not sure he's the conservative in the race. How does the race look to you?
Look, I mean, I'm the only candidate in the race, you know, Hugh, that can point to results with respect to conservative issues. I was a conservative leading the most liberal agency in the U.S. government. When I went into that agency, serving Donald Trump in this country, you know, within 18 months, we were energy independent. We had exited the Paris Accord. You know, we had truly restored confidence in the American people that agency was not going to be weaponized against agriculture, weaponized against energy, weaponized against manufacturing. And all that changed in 18 months. And we did it in the face of tremendous headwinds, as you know, tremendous opposition. And so, look, at the end of the day, we need people in the U.S. Senate that are full of courage to take on the tough issues and actually get results. There's no one in the race that can show that except me.
I want to talk about that courage thing for a moment, Scott Pruitt, because I met up with you at Hoover at Stanford, where you were surprised by very aggressive demonstrators. I mean, I was stunned that they kind of ambushed you up there, but they made your life a living hell for the years that you led EPA because you were getting stuff done. Do Oklahoma voters remember that?
Look, I mean, I believe so, Hugh, and you know this. There's been only one other person in the history of the EPA that has gone into that agency to lead with conviction and make changes. It was Justice Gorsuch's mom, Ann Gorsuch, that served Ronald Reagan. And like Ed Meese, who served Ronald Reagan faithfully, who was criticized and attacked and protesters on his front lawn, you know, when Reagan said if Ed Meese is no good man or is not a good man, there's no good men left in Washington. I mean, you know this. When you go to Washington to make a change, when you go to Washington to make a difference, you're going to be what? You're going to be attacked. And that's exactly what took place with many in the administration for President Trump. And that's because we were about change. And we served the American people, and it really was the American people first in trying to do all these changes. And so the left doesn't like that. The radicals don't like that. And they respond just like they did at Stanford when we went there and just like they did in Washington on a day-to-day basis.
Now, General Pruitt, just walk me through. When is the primary? When is the runoff? I know when the general is.
June 28th is the primary date, and that's really the only date we're focused upon right now, Hugh. I mean, the runoff would be in August, but unless you get 50% plus one in the election in Oklahoma, then there's a runoff. And with so many people in the race, I think that there's an anticipation that that's going to take effect. I mean, I got in the race late. You know, I decided on the last day of filing to enter the race. We have been putting together the political infrastructure. The momentum is starting. People see the difference. They know what I did as Attorney General. They know what I did as EPA Administrator. They know that I was willing to take on some tough issues and truly achieve good outcomes for the American people. And we need that kind of leadership in the U.S. Senate. We don't have enough of that. You know, I dealt with those folks on a day-by-day basis as I served as EPA administrator. And there's some really good, strong leaders in the U.S. Senate, good, strong leaders in the U.S. Congress. They just need, they need the cavalry. They need people coming, you know, to support their efforts and to advance. And I seek to be one of those people.
Scott Pruitt, always good to talk to you. Thank you, General. Keep coming back. Before June 28th, we will talk again, I'm sure. I cover that race extensively because it's very hard to replace Jim Inhofe. Very hard to replace Jim Inhofe. Scott Pruitt's got courage. He's got a record. And I hope the people who are listening in Oklahoma City and Tulsa this morning know that. I want to remind everyone, ReliefFactor.com is a sponsor of the show. All last week, I took it twice a day, right? All last week, I took it twice a day. Why? Because I had fallen square on my hip, took the header, did the face plant, and I've got the bruises to show for it. Back to once a week, took it in the first hour. Why? Because I was able to do 2.5-3 miles yesterday. I'm not running yet. That still is a little bit of a jolt to be out there and try and run. But I can walk pretty fast, and I'm staying away from those malignant branches. They used to just reach out for my golf ball. Now they got my foot. And so I understand. I do not know why the Ents are against me. Ricardo in Miami taunted me a little bit over the weekend. And I explained to him that I've had this ongoing battle with trees since I was a golfer. Now, Ricardo, who is a plus one, I call him Ricardo, but, you know, everybody knows his name is Hauser. And he's a plus one. And so I just want to warn everyone in Miami, if there's a guy hanging around the starter tee, and he's been taunting me about, you know, older men and injuries. And so I just want people to know, if you see a guy and he looks like, he might be able to shoot 90. I'll play with him. And he gets up there, he kind of shuffles up a little bit, and he's very, hello, hi, nice to see you. And you can't imagine the guy. And he says, what do you shoot to? He says, I don't know, I haven't played this course much. What are you? And he'll find out and say, well, that's really good. What do you feel like? And he never, ever, ever, ever tells you a falsehood. You just underestimate him. He's underestimated. What did W say about Hauser? Misunderestimated? I think that was about Hauser. So I'm just warning you right now. Don't feel generous. These people, like Rodney Dangerfield and Caddyshack, this is the quiet version of that. He is the ball. Be the ball. Now, let me go back and play for you. 1-800-520-1234, connection to the Hugh Hewitt Show. I do want to play for you Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez talking about unborn life. Cut number 7.
For people or maybe who say, not. Oh, but you're harming a life. I believe this is life. Well, some religions don't. So how about that? Our Jewish brothers and sisters, they are able to have an abortion according to their faith. You know, there are so many faiths that do not have the same definition of life as fundamentalist Christians. And so what about their rights? What about their right to exercise their faith? It's ridiculous. And it is.
I want to give AOC 24/7 access to every cable channel in America, not just Facebook. Let her come everywhere. I'm coming right back, America. Stay tuned. Morgan Ortagus joins me next. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Thank you for joining me. Morgan Ortagus served Mike Pompeo and President Trump as spokesperson for the United States. I want to talk to her about the decision of President Biden to say military engagement would follow. But first, an update on the Tennessee race from which she was booted by a corrupt Tennessee Republican establishment. Morgan, you chose not to sue them. And I just can't believe Frank Nicely and the good old boys drinking bourbon got away with this. Would you tell people what happened?
Well, you know, TBD on getting away with it. I think that one of the things that I've heard from Hugh, from all of my Tennessee donors and the people in Tennessee who are supporting me, and this is long-time old Tennessee families, you know, the thing that they've all told me is that they're just horrifically embarrassed by this situation, and I think it's really catalyzed people for change and for transparency. Essentially what happened is, for your listeners who don't know, Tennessee is an open primary state. So when you go to register to vote in Tennessee, unlike many states, you don't go to register as a Republican or a Democrat. You register, and I'm on the streets of Lviv, by the way, Ukraine. So if you're people hear background noise, if your listeners hear background noise, that's why. But when you go to register in Tennessee, you don't register for political parties. So the political parties have to make up rules in order to keep, you know, for Republicans, for example, they make up rules so that Democrats don't run as Republicans in their primaries. So it certainly makes sense on the surface. One of the things, you know, that they do is they ultimately have final say over who goes on the ballot. And there was a secret meeting that was called. There is no record of the meeting. There was no record of the vote. There was an anonymous vote. So you have to understand, a secret meeting where no one could attend and defend themselves. I think it was virtual, so you couldn't get into it. And then again, an anonymous vote on who would make the final Republican ballot. The Republican Party ultimately removed me and three others. And I can only speak for myself to say, I think my lifelong service to the Republican Party and two Republican presidents as a political appointee, and raising hundreds of thousands of dollars to Republican candidates from around the country from Maverick PAC. You may not agree with me on everything, but I think it's pretty clear that I'm not a Democrat, a Republican. But, you know, they chose to kick me and a few others off in a secret meeting with an anonymous vote, no public recording of it. So we need some transparency in our party, and there's plenty of great people in the Tennessee GOP, I should say. Great county leaders, people that are passionate and care about conservative values. And so I'll be working with those people for the ultimate betterment and good of the party and more transparency.
Did Senator Nicely bring up the fact that you are Jewish?
He brought it up to a reporter in an on-the-record interview with NBC News, and then I believe doubled down on it in an interview with ABC News. And it was, he did bring it up. He essentially said that the only people that wouldn't care if I was on the ballot were President Trump's Jewish daughter and son-in-law, because I'm Jewish. Which, by the way, you know, to dispel that myth, I am very close to Jared and Ivanka. They are very good friends. I worked on Abraham Accords with Jared and with Ivanka. I helped launch a women's initiative. So I've never shied away with the fact that I think they're great people and good friends. Saying that, my meeting with President Trump was a one-on-one meeting. I've known him for a long time. I worked for him for 2 years. I was in the trenches. There was no one in the room, just me and him. So, you know, just to dispel the local, you know, myths about how I got the, you know, the endorsement from him, it's something he wanted me to do.
President Trump wanted you to come to the White House for a while, and then Mike Pompeo talked him out of it because he needed you at state to represent the United States. I just think it's disgusting that there's anti-Semitism in the Tennessee Republican Party. And I don't know how widespread it is. It's just disgusts me. Morgan,
well, for the record, let me just say one quick thing, and we'll move to Russia. If I could just say, Senator Marsha Blackburn called out Senator Nicely. She stood up. She was very loud, very vocal. And I just
good for
give her.
Her
credit for being a good voice.
Good for her. Let me ask you about, are you supporting one of the, I had General Winstead on because I looked and I'm going to support that guy, the Brigadier General in the Tennessee National Guard. Have you got a candidate now that they tossed you out because you're Jewish and they don't like you?
Yeah, you know, I've worked the past 20 years I've been in politics, I've always tried to focus on getting veterans and young people elected. I'm with you. I'm going to support Senator Kurt Winstead, General Winstead, maybe Senator one day, but General Winstead.
Well, I think that's what people now, very quickly, the president today said he's going to defend Taiwan with military force. I welcome that. People at the White House are saying there's no change. That's a change. He finally said it out loud. He said the quiet part out loud, Morgan. What do you make of that?
So I'm with you, however, with you with a caveat. My caveat is I do not believe that Biden's defense budget reflects his rhetoric. And that's where I think that I have a problem with his policy pronouncements. Are actually serious about defending Taiwan. Mike Gallagher, who you've had on quite a bit, could go into this even more detail than me. But you need a serious naval budget and a much more serious military budget if you're actually going to make it.
Well, Morgan, you're breaking up on us, which is not surprising since you're in Lviv, Ukraine. Stay safe over there, representing freedom to the Ukrainians, as she did from the podium of the State Department. And we don't care about the anti-Semites in Tennessee's Republican hierarchy. We think it would be great in the Congress. I hope it does come on down the road. Hey, America, stay tuned. Hour number 3 of the Hugh Hewitt Show, straight ahead.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Prison Fellowship Academy.
Morning, Glory America. Bonjour. Hi, Canada. Hugh Hewitt live inside the Beltway on this Monday morning, joined by Senator Roger Marshall from the great state of Kansas. Good morning, Senator. How are you?
Hugh, good morning. The sun came up again. It's May 23rd, and Title 42 is supposed to end, according to Joe Biden.
You know, I got to talk to you about that. I want to preface it. 107,000 Americans died of overdoses last year. For years, we have been working on the opioid crisis in the United States, and I think, actually, the homegrown pill crisis is under control as prescribers and manufacturers get their act together. But fentanyl, it's a river of fentanyl coming across the border. And I think you went down there and took a look at it, did you not?
Right. Actually, I'm still down here. I've been down here all weekend. It is just literally a human tragedy, a sea of suffering humanity, and Joe Biden has caused this problem. He sent out a signal for everybody to come here today. And to your point on the fentanyl, most every day a Kansan dies from fentanyl poisoning. Last year, over the past year, 6 tons of fentanyl crossed the border. One pill can kill. And what they're doing is they're lacing, these are professionals, they're lacing marijuana, cocaine, Percocets, oxycodone pills with a little bit of fentanyl. There's enough fentanyl in it to kill somebody. Maybe just as little as like the lead on a pencil tip is enough to kill somebody.
So, Doctor, why, and I say doctor because Senator Marshall is also Dr. Marshall, what do the cartels get out of that? Why do they put fentanyl into the pills that people are buying illegally over the Internet?
You know, that's a good question, and I think it's just kind of the drug du jour. It's the wine of the week. You can transport such a small amount and get it a little bit more easily across the border. You can get six-year-olds to have a backpack full of fentanyl worth hundreds of thousands of dollars. So Joe Biden is paying the fentanyl to transport the humans across $3,000 to $7,000 a piece, and then on top of that, they're smuggling in the drugs. So just such a small amount of it is very lethal, and it creates quite a buzz too. So rather than getting a little buzz from a Percocet or marijuana, this is going to give a person a huge buzz. But what they don't realize, it's also going to make you stop breathing.
It is 107,000 Americans died last year. That number went up. It's going up every year. So the border crisis is a human tragedy because people are being trafficked. Some of these people coming over are going right to warehouses where they're exploited sexually. Some of them are going into the equivalent of slavery. And many of them are mules for fentanyl. And I just got to ask you, what do you see with your eyes that you didn't know with your head by going down there, Dr. Marshall?
Well, I think just the enormity of it, just the amount of human suffering. Hugh, I was just in Poland 3 or 4 weeks ago, and the situation on their border is not as tragic as what I'm seeing here. I've been across the world doing humanitarian efforts as a physician, and this is as bad as I've seen anywhere. I shouldn't get nauseated as much as I've seen. It is so troubling for me to go to the border and just be emotionally disturbed to see the suffering, to see a six-year-old girl, an eight-year-old girl who has been brought across the country of Mexico, over 1,000 miles on foot, to get across the border, to be fished out by the Border Patrol, and just see the tragedy on their faces, to see our detention centers overcrowded. And I got to stop right here and just mention, our Border Patrol officers are doing an incredible job. They're doing everything humanly possible, but they're just overwhelmed. And this crisis is unsustainable. Governor Abbott doing an incredible job. He's provided layer after layer of law enforcement officers, the Department of Public Safety. He has his state troopers down here on the river. So it is a war zone. When the sun goes down, this river turns into a war zone.
Senator Marshall, you mentioned Title 42, and it's Title 42, I think, Section 165, says there will not be any kind of consideration for refugee status for political persecution if you're coming from a country in which a disease is rampant. We all know Mexico does not have COVID policies in place. We all know that Central America has complete meltdown on their public health system. Why are they lifting Section 42, which makes it easy to return people to Mexico?
Well, Hugh, they want to remake America. Remember, your listeners need to know, Joe Biden wants this crisis. He thinks that these are future voters for the Democrat Party. There's no other reason to do, that this is happening. He could easily stop this problem. And you may recall, way before there was Title IV, I was asking Dr. Fauci live at a hearing at the Senate, why are we stopping them because of tuberculosis? Why are we stopping them because of mumps and chickenpox and gonorrhea and syphilis? All those issues as well. There was already reason to institute Title 42 before COVID became rampant in Mexico. So this is all politically driven. Joe Biden wants this crisis. He wants these people coming to your hometown.
Now, Senator Marshall, I said on Howard Kurtz's show yesterday, Republicans should avoid using the term replacement theory because white supremacists have seized on it. I do think we need to talk about the border and bringing control to it. If the Republicans get the Senate majority and the House majority, will they pass legislation that is basically veto-proof to reinstate 42 and indeed finish the wall?
Well, I can only wish so, Hugh. You realize on the Senate it'll take 60 votes to pass any legislation like you're describing. I've supported legislation like that. If I could do one thing, and even just talking to the Border Patrol officers yesterday, the people at the port, again, that are doing great jobs, these port of entries, they described President Trump's fence, that it, what it did was provide a funnel to push people to the right places. And once they get to the port of authority, they do an incredible job of processing their folks. The technology's improved. Now, they're at a level two of crisis as far as the number of people. Remember President Trump calling that the golden gate into this country if you do it the right way. So I do think there's a legislation that we could work on. I've worked on it before. Something that would, first and foremost, though, is to secure the border. It would probably take $25 billion to do that. Not just building a fence, but improved technology, more officers, more drug dogs. And remember, the president just spent $40 billion yesterday on the Ukrainian border issue.
Hey, I'm glad that he did. But tell me something, Senator Marshall. You have Democratic friends. You get along with everybody. Okay. What do they say about this? Are they just closing their eyes to the misery, to the suffering, and to the 107,000 dead Americans?
Yes, they are. I mean, this is not a priority to them. All they would want to know is what's the carbon footprint of these people coming across the border. And maybe we should, you know, and how do we, maybe we should be giving them a bicycle rather than flying jets. I don't know. Hugh, this is simply not a priority to the Democrat Party. I've not heard one person mention it. You know, I take that back. There's been a few border Democrat senators that have mentioned that this is a problem, but they're not serious about solving it.
I don't think Senator Kelly has any credibility on this. I saw over the weekend he said don't suspend 42. It took him until he saw his polls. He's going to get blown out in the Arizona election. So let me conclude this way, Dr. Marshall. How long are you going to be down there, and who went with you? I want to know who made the trip, because if people who are legislators don't even look, I can't trust their judgment.
Right. So no other legislators went with me on this trip. This is my fourth time here. I took 5 sheriff's officers. And I want them to go back, and if they can save one Kansan's life by what they learned on being patrol with us. We went out with the sheriff's officers at a checkpoint, just beyond a checkpoint, participated in the takedown of some human smugglers. There's significant punishment. So that's the story, Hugh.
Senator Marshall, thank you for joining me this morning. I'll talk to you when you get back to Washington, D.C. I hope you bring that message back. And tell it, we just have to secure the border. I've been saying this since 2004. I told Howard Kurtz yesterday, my position has not changed. It's sort of like voting. Make it easy to vote and hard to cheat. Make it easy to immigrate into the United States. Make it easy to get legalization, regularization is what I call, because I don't think people who enter illegally ever ought to be allowed to vote. If you break the laws of the United States to get here, I don't think you ought to ever be able to vote in the United States, but I'm not for throwing you out. I'm for generous-minded, locally controlled regularization of people who entered the country illegally. But we've got to stop the drugs. It is a malign force. And I don't mean drugs like the kind of drugs that was around when I was in college or for the next 40 years. Fentanyl is different. Fentanyl kills you. It just kills you. And why they feel I think the answer is there's a market for the extraordinary high that you get that most people think they're immune. They got their narco kit, whatever that is that you take, they've got it standing by, but they screw up or they don't know. And I've read too many stories of teenagers who thought they would get a sedative, thought they would get a hydrocodone or a Percocet and get a buzz on with a couple of beers, who end up dead because they didn't realize that fentanyl was in their drug of choice. This is not the time to be other than bipartisan. It is a crisis. They should not lift Title 42. They should finish the wall, and they should be generous in welcoming people who are here who can prove that they are productive. Stay America. I'll be right back on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of The Hugh Hewitt Show brought to you by Sierra Pacific Mortgage. For more info, call 888-888-1172.
Welcome back, America. Kurt Schlichter is going to be in for me tomorrow. I'm flying out to California for a couple of days meeting with my Salem host. I got to meet Officer Brandon Tatum. I'm really looking forward to it. Maybe I can get him up really early in California. Richard Blythe is going to produce the show for me from our gathering. And Officer Tatum has really made a splash in the world of radio. I'm looking forward to meeting the fella. Also looking forward, I don't know if Andrew and Todd are going to be there. I hope, though. Sometimes sponsors come. And AndrewandTodd.com have been a sponsor of this show forever, and I love seeing the guys. I go see them whenever I'm in Southern California, even if there's not a meeting of the Salem family of hosts and managers and everybody else, advertisers. I like to see AndrewandTodd.com because we actually talk substance about the mortgage markets. This morning, by the way, across the sea, all right, across the sea, it's a good day. England's up 1%. Germany up almost 1%, France up 0.5%. I don't know what the markets are going to do today. There's some pessimism that we're going to hit a real bear market, a deep bear market. I actually don't think that's going to be the case, but I am not an expert. I am pretty good on home buying, though. I know I use AndrewandTodd.com for a reason. I have bought and sold houses since I was 24. The Fetching Mrs. Hewitt and I bought our first house at 24, 25, and the interest rate was 12.5%. And since then, three or four times in Virginia, a few times in California, back into Virginia. I've gone through the process. It's never easy to get the mortgage, right? It's never a walk in the park. But the easiest it's ever been, and this counts for refinance, is with AndrewandTodd.com. Now, the 10-year Treasury this morning dropped over the weekend. It's at 2.787%. That's not the rate you get on a 30-year fixed. It's the rate on which 30-year fixed are based. So when that falls, and it was above 3% last week, because inflation's got a grip on the United States, and the good news about the market sell-off over the last month is that it eased the pressure on the 10-year Treasury, which eases the pressure on the 30-year fixed rate and on the ARMs. So do yourself a favor. The opportunity is there. The demand has dropped a little bit. You're not going to find 30 people trying to get the same house. Get pre-qualified. That means you get a letter from Andrew and Todd, and it tells the home seller that you have already qualified for a loan with Sierra Pacific Mortgage. That's AndrewandTodd.com or with them. But you can't get started until you pick up the phone. 888-888-1172, or you head over to AndrewandTodd.com. Story of the morning. I'm going to talk about it with Bret Stevens after the break. New York Times columnist. We're going to mostly talk about the abortion cases coming down. But I want you to hear what Joe Biden said in Japan about 3 hours ago. Can you play that for me, please?
We agree with a one China policy. We signed on to it and all the attendant agreements made from there. But the idea that it can be taken by force is just not appropriate.
Are you willing to get involved militarily to defend Taiwan if it comes to that?
Yes.
You are.
That's the commitment we made.
All right, so I don't know why the reporter said you are, disbelievingly. Some of the White House press tries to cover for the president when he does a face plant. That was not a face plant. That was a very intentional yes. Yes, we will defend Taiwan militarily. And I know that people in the White House are scurrying around, the peaceniks, the anti-American crowd, they're in the staff. They want people not to believe what they heard. The president's done this three times. We will act. All right? We will act. Good for him. Credit where credit is due. Credit is due to ReliefFactor.com. They are my longtime sponsor. And you know, a week ago Saturday, I took a face plant on a malignant tree, a villainous branch. Reached out and got me. I saw it, but I didn't see the one in front of it. It was like a trap. And so I went down hard on that branch and ended up in the ER. Nothing is broken. And sure enough, I'm able to walk up steps without pain now. And I can walk. And after the show, I can't run yet. That jars a little bit too much. And it's just a deep bone bruise, what they call a hip pointer. And it's not the most pleasant thing in the world. But you know what? Swelling is what you can't deal with. And ice and heat and ReliefFactor.com worked. And I did 2.5 miles yesterday. Walked to church, walked to CVS, got everything done I needed to get done. And it was a busy weekend. I had it was double coupon day on grandkids on Friday. Unexpectedly, I had two grandchildren arrive. One, they're hundreds of miles apart, and they were 8 hours apart in time. But I am doubly blessed. by grandchildren 4 and 5. The little angel who came early is under 5 pounds, so your prayers are accepted, please, for both of them. But they're doing fine. Moms and babies are fine. I'm a happy man, and I'm walking again because of ReliefFactor.com. Stay tuned. Bret Stephens is next. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, joined by Bret Stevens, one of America's finest columnists. He writes for the New York Times. Good morning, Bret. How are you?
Hugh, I'm fine. How are you doing?
I'm good. I want to talk mostly about your column of May 3rd, overturning Roe is a radical, not conservative choice. But before I do, since we agree on international issues a lot, let me play for you the president in Japan this morning with the prime minister of Japan at his side. Can we play that cut for him, please?
We agree with a one China policy. We signed on to it and all the attendant agreements made from there. But the idea that it can be taken by force, just taken by force, is just not appropriate.
Are you willing to get involved militarily to defend Taiwan if it comes to that?
Yes.
You are?
That's the commitment we made.
I see very smart people like Gerard Baker, Jerry Dunleavy saying the White House is already walking this back, Bret Stevens. What do you make of this?
I think it's the right call by the president. I'll tell you why. The One China policy is increasingly a dead letter. I wish it weren't, but that was a change that was really brought about by Xi Jinping at the 70th, or I guess it was the 100th anniversary of the Communist Party last year. And when posed with this kind of direct question in the midst of the Ukrainian war, if he had said anything other than that, I think it would have been a moment like 1950 when ambiguity from the United States invited communist aggression in Korea.
So, I agree with that, Bret. That was Dean Acheson at the press club in 1950, and a lot of apologists have said he didn't mean it. But you're right. The moment and the question called for that kind of clarity, and I think the White House staff walking it back is inimical to the idea that Joe Biden is president.
Yeah, no, I think they're making a mistake here because they're playing into the suggestion that the president is not in control of his wits or his mouth or his mind or whatever, which at this moment in time is problematic for deterrence. I think given the question that he was asked, the president said the right thing. I hope the message was heard clearly in Beijing.
So we agree, and we agree completely. Let's talk about where we disagree, your column of May 3rd. People can go and read it. I'm not going to selectively quote. How would you summarize, Bret, your position on Dobbs as it looms? It might be released in the next hour, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, well, it'll be interesting to see what happens. My view was that Roe v. Wade was incorrectly decided in January of 1973, nearly 50 years ago. But it has been the law of the land for a half century, and I think that overturning it now, as seems likely from the leaked draft of Alito's opinion, would be a radical and not a conservative decision that would have unintended consequences, which we conservatives would regret.
Now, what I want to talk to you about is the term radical. I've been teaching con law for 25 years, Bret, and I don't want to throw case names at you. But my view of the reason that you are incorrect in this assessment is that Roe was effectively overruled by Casey, where the three-judge joint opinion of Souter, Kennedy, and Justice O'Connor attempted to impose and implored the country to accept a solution that said basically 4.5 to 5 months, no restrictions, and thereafter any restriction goes. You say that that is, in fact, the anchor on which people ought to stand. Is that a fair character, that it's radical to overturn Casey, not Roe? Because Roe is effectively the dead letter.
Well, I don't agree with you that Casey overturned Roe, and I don't think Brett Kavanaugh would agree with you that Casey overturned Roe. He called Casey precedent upon precedent during his confirmation hearing. I think Casey amended Roe in that it changed the trimester, I mean, substantively changed the trimester scheme on which Roe had initially been based, but abortion rights were substantially left untouched in the wake of Casey when it appeared that they might have been overturned. And by the way, you know, in 1990, what was it, two, when Casey was decided, and Roe was less than 20 years old. I think if Casey had gone the other way, if Kennedy and Souter hadn't changed their minds in that decision, I would have less of a problem. I would have had less of a problem then. My contention here is that we have had what amounts to a settled law for 50 years, and change from above, decided by two or three unelected justices of the Supreme Court, would be so extraordinarily disruptive to the way in which Americans, and particularly obviously American women, understand their reproductive rights, that it would be precisely the kind of change that we conservatives usually object to, which is an unelected body deciding, like philosopher kings, to change the way we understand our constitutional rights. Now, you can make the argument that Roe, you know, that abortion never should have been a constitutional right, and that it was a bad decision, and therefore, like, say, Plessy v. Ferguson, another bad decision, it doesn't matter how much time has elapsed, it needs to be overturned. But the difference there, Hugh, I would say, is that what happened with Plessy, which gave birth to the evils of Jim Crow, is that Plessy withdrew rights that had been advanced to African Americans, and then Brown, starting with Brown v. Board, those rights were restored. What you have in this case is a right that has been advanced that is now being withdrawn, and I think that's fundamentally different.
And the response, and I just want to take a minute. I don't want to throw case law at you, but I've got to, because I just don't think you know this, is that the right that's being restored with the Dobbs draft is the right of the people to decide this question as they deem fit in their states. What's being restored is federalism. And what part of your argument that is missing is that it is not settled since 1992. In fact, you left out Stenberg v. Carhart and Gonzalez v. Carhart, a 2000 decision and a 2003 decision. My guess is you don't know those cases. Am I right about that, Bret?
Yeah, no, I don't pretend to be a constitutional scholar, so I don't know.
Okay, see if this informs, not many people do. In Stenberg, Nebraska passed an abortion law, an anti-late-term abortion, partial birth abortion law, and it was struck down as unconstitutional despite the Casey standard that was supposed to settle it. Justice O'Connor switched to the liberal side. Justice Kennedy dissented and was outraged because he said, we settled this in 1992, and basically, Sandra, what are you doing? In 2003, in Gonzalez versus Carhart, when the court had changed again, the late-term prohibition of the Congress was upheld. And so what you saw was Kennedy trying to restore the standard of 1992, the Casey standard. But in fact, what was on display is that it's a political football that hasn't been settled in 50 years. And the right we ought to restore is that of the people to decide. As Churchill said, trust the people. So until and unless your argument accounts for the Stenberg and Gonzalez take back, the left's attempt to unsettle what was supposedly settled in 1992, it's not radical to say we see what the left is doing and we're going to play the same game, which is to ask the court to get out of it, because the left never will.
Hang on a second, okay? Because what you're talking about is essentially fiddling or questions of abortion rights at the margins, not the central right across the United States for women to have access to a legal abortion within some sorts of parameters. Second case you're making about federalism is one I'm perfectly familiar with. I understand the argument that this argument on the conservative side that this is a matter that is best left to the states. Now, if you're one of the ironies of that view is that if your concern here is that the people should decide at the level of states, then you are potentially licensing unrestricted abortion laws that go far, far beyond the standards set in Roe and Casey to allow, you know, what would practically amount to infanticide in some of the most liberal cases, which is probably not a consequence that most opponents of Roe v. Wade have in mind.
Secondly, well, Bret, that is
But the question of federalism is also an important one, because federalism exists within certain limits, including the due process clause of the 14th Amendment. And one of the interesting things I find in reading Alito's case is his argument is that basically Roe was just too recent a vintage, which is to say 50 or 49 and a half years, to be considered a kind of a foundational right in the way that some of the other implied rights granted by the 14th Amendment are foundational rights. I would simply argue with that. Three generations of women have come of age understanding that a right to an abortion is a right that they enjoy as a constitutionally protected right. You withdraw this, and I think the consequences to our understanding of rights and to the standing of the court is going to be dramatic, and we're going to rue it in the way that we now rue taking Baghdad.
Now, let me talk to you about the first point. The constitutional licensing of late-term abortion and practically infanticide already exists in blue states like California that have constitutionalized it. And indeed, women can have abortions up to the day before birth and indeed during birth. That is the law of the land in California and in other jurisdictions that choose what I think to be morally reprehensible, but nevertheless are reflective of the political culture of that state. So what your first argument, it's a non sequitur because that already exists. We're not licensing that via Dobbs. No one is licensing anything. The political argument moves. But what you don't, I don't think you just deal with it, Bret, is that the argument, three generations of American women and three generations of American men and all generations of American citizens have grown up with a political football. The only march that every year draws a 500,000 people is the pro-life march. It has never been settled. It is always the subject of choice and change, and states continue to throw up attempts to overturn Casey or the, quote, settled law, even as states continue to throw up expansions. The only thing that has been constant is the political conflict set off by Roe. And the only way to get out of that particularly thick woods, which is destructive of comity and common sense, is to let the people decide. And we will have a patchwork of laws like we do on, for example, every other fundamental right, voting. But what Alito said about fundamental rights analysis is and has been true. The other fundamental rights, like the right to contraception, is rooted in the right to control your family, which dates back to the 20s and beyond at the time. And they existed at the time of the passage of the 14th Amendment. You get a minute to the break, Bret, and then so go ahead.
Well, I'm actually not entirely clear why exactly, after overturning Roe, the court also wanted to overturn Griswold on precisely the same standard that Samuel Alito has set, which is that this is a right to privacy found nowhere in the Constitution, right? The words, the right to privacy, as my reading of the Constitution suggests, doesn't exist. And so it actually opens the way to overturning in some states those rights. I think
when we come back, we'll talk about what happens when a political settlement occurs post Griswold. There is no one anywhere proposing the repeal of Griswold or the repeal of Obergefell. We need to take account of the facts as they exist. And when a settlement occurs, the settlement abides. It has never occurred with Roe. Bret Stephens is my guest. I'll be right back after the break, America. Stay tuned. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, live inside the Beltway, talking with New York Times columnist Bret Stephens about his May 3rd column about the Dobbs decision. He opposes as radical Justice Alito's draft decision. And he said this, I want to quote this one line. This is partly a matter of stare decisis, but not just that, you wrote. As conservatives, you are philosophically bound to give considerable weight to judicial precedents, particularly when they have been ratified and refined, as Roe was by the 1992 Planned Parenthood v. Casey decision over a long period. We talked about that, but we haven't talked about stare decisis yet, Bret. And I want to begin by talking about Citizens United. Did you support the decision of the Supreme Court in Citizens United, which struck down most of the McCain-Feingold Act?
Yes, but I'm having second thoughts about the decision.
Okay, but that's a political policy, right? You might want to try and, I mean, it's a First Amendment decision, and Chief Justice Roberts did not write the majority opinion, but he concurred wholly in it, and he wrote about, and I would recommend to you, his 2010 decision about what it takes to overturn a 30-year precedent, which is what they did in, they overturned the Austin case.
Yeah.
And so what he wrote is, quote, stare decisis is the preferred course because it promotes the even-handed, predictable, and consistent development of legal principles, fosters reliance on judicial decisions, and contributes to the actual and perceived integrity of the judicial process. And he says it is not a mechanical formula, citing, among other things, Lawrence v. Texas, which was overturned. That was the 1986 decision upholding anti-sodomy laws that was overturned a decade later. If it were, segregation would be legal, minimum wage laws would be unconstitutional, and the government could wiretap ordinary criminal suspects without first obtaining warrants. So the stare decisis decision of 30 years, you're arguing 30 years is enough. Unless you came out saying that Citizens United was radical, you've got two standards for two different areas of law.
Well, hang on a second. What I write is this is partly a matter of stare decisis, but not just that. So I'm aware that stare decisis is not a sufficient argument, so I go on to say this is also a matter of originalism. And I quote Alexander Hamilton from Federalist 78, to avoid an arbitrary discretion in the courts, it is indispensable that they, meaning the judges, should be bound down by strict rules and precedents which serve to define and point out their duty in every particular case that comes before them, end quote. So this idea, I mean, of course, I'm not a fool. I understand that not every previous court decision was rightly decided, and every now and then they are overturned. But the weight they should be given, I think, is fairly considerable, particularly when, and this is my core argument to you, Hugh, particularly when a decision like Roe or Casey has advanced to a huge class of people a right that they have enjoyed and taken for granted for generations. That, I think, is something that deserves a hell of a lot more consideration than the question of whether corporations should be treated as having, as enjoying First Amendment rights.
Well, this is where we fundamentally disagree. They have not taken it for granted. As you have seen, the abortion debate is never ending. And it will never end because it concerns first principles on the status of the unborn child. And I don't think anyone argues that it's not a child in the ninth month. A lot of people argue that early term abortions in the first month don't make a difference. Mm-hmm. And by the way, I don't believe there's any way a court is going to strike down, because of the Commerce Clause, the FDA's decision to license the morning after pill. And there's no way that the court is going to wade into the California constitutional framework. When they are done with it, they're going to be done with it. And here is the key argument why I think yours is the radical position, not the conservative position. The abortion jurisprudence continues to distort and pervert our law in other areas, especially with regards to free speech, especially with regards to First Amendment rights. And Justice Scalia used to say, unless until we get rid of the idea that a majority vote of 9 unelected people makes the law in the United States, we are in a world of hurt. That's a paraphrase. And we're going to see that again. And it's just never going to stop because it's a religious matter. And unless you trust the people of the states, or you get 60 votes to pass the radical law that Chuck Schumer wanted to pass, we are just postponing and continuing the fraying of the national conversation.
Look, in some sense, I agree with you, Hugh, which is to say that if in fact this decision comes down substantially the way Alito has written it on a 5-4, 6-3 vote, the abortion argument is going to continue. In fact, I think it's going to do more to make, it's going to make our politics more vicious. I think it is going to degrade the integrity of the court. This leak of the decision, which I rue and condemn, and I think is a horror, along with protests outside of the homes of justices, are going to become that much more intense. And that's why I say to you, Hugh, this is going to be the domestic policy equivalent of American troops in Baghdad, which is going to be something we will regret in later years. I guess that I think that the expression is Pyrrhic victory.
And what I say to you, if we're going to use that analogy, eventually you have to withdraw from a field that is contested. You don't want to withdraw like we withdrew in Afghanistan, unannounced, without anyone knowing, and without any kind of security for those on one side.